Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is portfolio questions, and the first portfolio is Constitution, External Affairs and Culture and Parliamentary Business. As ever, I would make a plea for succinct questions and answers in order to allow as many members to get in as possible. And at question number one, I call Brian Whittle, who is remote. Mr. Whittle.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to ensure that children and young people have opportunity to engage with fine arts and performing arts such as music, drama and art.
Cabinet Secretary Angus Robertson.
The Scottish Government's long-standing investment in the Youth Music Initiative has helped young people across Scotland to access music-making opportunities and to develop wider skills and learning. To improve accessibility of theatre for school pupils, the National Theatre of Scotland, one of the five national performing companies which receives funding from the Scottish Government, manages a dedicated Theatres in School programme, and Expressive Arts within Scotland's curriculum provides a platform for teachers to use interdisciplinary approaches and to work collaboratively with cultural organisations to increase opportunities for children and young people to engage with the arts.
Brian Whittle.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer, but many of us first engage with the arts, such as music, drama and the art, in the school curriculum, and we know that access to arts in school has been consistently eroded by the Scottish Government. So can I ask the Cabinet Secretary if he still believes that a broad education should include the arts, and what damage that lack of access to the arts in the education system is having to the future of performing arts, such as music, art and drama?
Cabinet Secretary.
Like Brian Whittle, I had the good fortune to go to a school where music and the arts were central to teaching and to learn a musical instrument, and even reaching the giddy heights of the Edinburgh Secondary School's orchestra. I agree with him that it's important that pupils right across Scotland get the opportunities to partake in culture and the arts. In my initial answer to Mr. Whittle's question, I outlined the ways in which this works extremely successfully. If Brian Whittle has any specific examples where he thinks there are deficiencies, I'd be happy to hear from him.
Supplementary, Bill Kidd.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline how the impact of reductions to arts and culture spending by the Westminster Government has impacted on Scotland's budget?
Cabinet Secretary.
The Scottish Government receives block funding through the Barnett formula on the total changes to UK departmental allocations in areas of devolved competence. The changes in spending by a UK Government department do not necessarily reflect an increase or decrease in that UK department's budget allocation, and so may not directly impact on Barnett consequentials. However, I would note that while the UK Tory Government and Welsh Labour Government, for that matter, have both cut culture spending, we in Scotland are increasing it.
And supplementary, Neil Bibby.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. What assessment has or will the Scottish Government make of the viability of film in the curriculum, given that the funding for the Screen Educator in Residence programme, which has supported it, ends this month, and how will the Government make sure that the progress built by the programme is not lost?
I think screen education has a huge potential in Scotland schools, and in fact there have been a number of pilot schools which have been implementing screen studies. It's something I'm very excited about. It's something that Screen Scotland is taking forward, and there's significant international interest in this. I'd be happy to update Neil Bibby to let him know about the plans for screen education being introduced into Scotland school. I think it's something that will have cross-party support.
Question number two, Maurice Golden.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions the Culture Secretary has had with ministerial colleagues regarding how the census output on Armed Forces veterans, due to be released on 13th of June, will be able to be used to inform a better understanding of the veterans community.
Cabinet Secretary.
Inclusion of a question on veteran status in the census for the first time marked a significant step forward in developing the evidence base on veterans in Scotland and their characteristics. Officials will analyse the outputs, which we will use to consider how we continue to support veterans and their families. The analysis will inform the discussions that the Veterans Minister has with other portfolio ministers, and a further update on our work to use emerging evidence to understand more about the circumstances and needs of veterans will be provided in the Veterans Minister's annual update to Parliament.
Maurice Golden.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that response and the inclusion of the question. The most recent data for the number of veterans of the UK Armed Forces resident in Scotland is 220,000, which was taken from the annual population survey conducted by the Office for National Statistics in 2017. Although we do know there is a reticence for veterans to identify as such, which means, in some cases, they cannot access the support services they need, how will the Cabinet Secretary utilise the census data to share with charities to aid them in targeting support for veterans?
Cabinet Secretary.
I think Maurice Golden asks an important question and gives me the opportunity to commend him for his work as a convener of the cross-party group on the Armed Forces and Veterans Community. And in this week, when we mark the 80th anniversary of the D-Day Allied landings in France, the importance of our veterans and armed forces community is recognised across the Scottish Parliament and by the Scottish Government. I give him the commitment that all relevant census information, once published, will be shared with Veterans Scotland and through them to all of their much-valued member charities, associations, trusts, organisations and veterans champions, which will help them in targeting support.
Question number 3, Carol Mochin, who is joining us remotely. Ms Mochin.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on what role local authorities have in preserving the heritage and culture of the areas that they serve.
Cabinet Secretary.
Scottish Government position towards local authorities is to ensure that they have the freedom to make independent decisions for their own communities. Local authorities have powers to designate conservation areas or areas of special architectural or historic interest under the Planning Listed Buildings and Conservation Areas Scotland Act of 1997. They have planning authority to safeguard local development decisions in their area in line with the national planning guidance and legislation in respect of historic assets, and local authorities may also develop their own heritage strategies to protect and celebrate heritage in their area.
Carol Mochin.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer? Local authorities, including SNP-run councils across Scotland, are being forced to make savings in areas such as libraries, cultural centres and key heritage sites as a result of year-on-year real-term cuts to their budgets from this government. If the Scottish Government values the role of local authorities play in preserving the heritage and culture of the areas they serve, why does it keep passing budgets that deliver brutal cuts to council that put heritage and culture sites across south of Scotland and the country at risk?
Well, the Scottish Government very much values the role that local authorities play in the provision of culture and heritage. I had the great pleasure to join the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities in recent weeks in hosting a meeting about this. Is there more that local authorities, is there more the Scottish Government can do within our current budgets? Well, I think we are all trying our best, but there's no getting away from the fact that we're having to work within the structures of a UK austerity policy being pursued by the Conservative Party and sadly being emulated by the UK Labour Party.
And supplementary, Claire Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can I ask the Cabinet Secretary to provide an update regarding the work of the Local and National Delivery Group and how this can help increase links between local and national initiatives?
Cabinet Secretary.
So far this year, the Local and National Delivery Group have helped to shape the development of a collaborative event jointly hosted by the Scottish Government and the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities. The event was held on the 20th of May and explored the value of culture in delivering a wealth of local outcomes with a view to developing partnership working across boundaries at a local and national level. The Scottish Government will work with Local and National Delivery Group to consider tangible next steps on the basis of the themes raised at the event.
Question number 4, Emma Roddick.
To ask the Scottish Government, as part of its work to further the case for Scottish independence, what engagement it has carried out with businesses regarding Scotland's constitutional future.
Cabinet Secretary.
This is a government that is engaged with and supportive of business, and ministers and officials met with a number of businesses and their representatives throughout the Building a New Scotland series. We'll continue to engage with and listen to Scotland's people, our civic organisations and our businesses to drive a growing economy that is fair and is green. The First Minister, in a recent speech to business leaders, advised that rejoining the European Union as an independent country and making our own economic decisions is the best way to meet the challenges facing businesses and to grow our economy.
Emma Roddick.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. The SNP Government has, of course, always supported small enterprise in my region, but many businesses are struggling due to the decisions taken out with Scotland on migration, trade and EU membership. Can he tell me how an independent Scotland will better serve Scottish business compared to Brexit Britain's current insular approach?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, Scotland is already a good place to do business, as the ongoing global success of many of our sectors and businesses testifies. As we set out in the Building a New Scotland prospectus papers, with greater powers over immigration, over employment and taxation, an independent Scotland in the European Union could learn from the UK's failures and from industrial policy successes elsewhere to build a business environment designed to maximise the economic benefits of the many opportunities facing Scotland, not least from the transition to net zero. And for colleagues who have not yet read any of the papers, in particular I draw their attention to the paper which compares the economic success of literally every single one of our neighbouring countries, which outperforms the United Kingdom.
Supplementary, Craig Hoy.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. When the Cabinet Secretary engages with business, is he able to give them any meaningful insight into the SNP's currency plans? His latest fictional white paper says as soon as practicable, Scotland would move to its own independent currency, the Scottish pound. Until then, the pound sterling would remain Scotland's currency. Would the Minister like to say how soon is as soon as practicable? And isn't this just the latest attempt to kick difficult cans down the road as they gloss over the very legitimate fears of Scottish business about his independence plans?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, no, is the short answer to Mr Hoy's question, but I would encourage him to actually read the paper. I'm not sure if he has, because if he had... Oh, he's shaking his head. He clearly hasn't. If he had, I'm sure he would have found the detail very convincing and hugely encouraging to Scotland. What we look forward to is the opportunity, living in a democracy, to be able to have a democratic say in a referendum about the country's future. Having a look at all of our neighbouring countries, which all outperform the United Kingdom, I think it's a prize worth joining together with across the chamber, although I suspect that that's not likely in the case of Mr Hoy.
Question number five. Willie Rennie, who's joining us remotely. Mr Rennie.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it plans to propose a parliamentary debate on the provision of early learning and childcare.
Stop. Minister Jamie Hepburn.
I recognise the member's long-standing interest in childcare. As he will be aware, the Parliamentary Bureau is responsible for proposing the Parliamentary Business Programme, which comes to Parliament for agreement. I would be happy to discuss with him and the relevant minister to determine whether the issue he raises today is one that I can bring to Bureau for consideration.
Willie Rennie.
That's a very helpful response from the Minister. Nothing, I would expect nothing less from him. It's really important that we try and take forward the commitment that was given by the last First Minister to close the gap between the funding for PVI sector, the private, voluntary and independent sector, and the council nurseries, because the gap is big and it's having an impact on the provision of staff, particularly experienced staff, in those nurseries in the private sector. So I'd be happy to meet with the Minister. Is it possible that we could have that meeting next week with the Minister for Children as well, so we can get this debate happening?
Minister.
Well, I can certainly commit to a meeting with Mr Rennie as soon as possible. I know the issues that he raises are ones that are important. Of course, notwithstanding the challenges, the private sector continues to grow. There are more professionals entering that part of the sector. But of course, we can meet and discuss these matters whilst I can't honestly say we have a debate planned in principle. I'd be very happy for us to have a debate. I'm quite open to it because, of course, it would enable us to debate the fact that we already have the most generous provision of early years learning and childcare in Scotland of any part of the United Kingdom.
Question number six, Clare Adamson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government how it supports people in the Wetherill and Wishaw constituency to access and participate in cultural activities.
Cabinet Secretary.
Through our support of the Culture Collective programme run by Creative Scotland, we supported real-time music based in Motherwell. Real-time music were awarded over £270,000 to deliver a project which included working with communities in Motherwell, in Glenboig, Airdrie and Bells Hill, as well as delivering region-wide projects with partners like Lanarkshire Deaf Club. Our Youth Music Initiative Access to Music Making Fund also provided support for a music project in Wishaw through the Glen Castles Community Development Project.
Claire Adamson.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. We have lost a number of extraordinary EU cultural exchange programmes because of Brexit, something that I know Real Time and both Castle Hills have taken part in the past. The Tories and Labour have rejected proposals from the EU for a freedom of movement for under 30s, again denying generations of young people these wonderful opportunities. Can I ask the Minister to set out what the Scottish Government's priorities are for giving opportunities to young people through cultural exchange?
Cabinet Secretary.
The loss of access to the Creative Europe programme has indeed had a major impact on young artists. This programme played a vital role in facilitating international cultural collaboration, helping young artists to develop cross-border networks, to share knowledge and learn from their peers. And the Scottish Government is calling on the UK Conservative Government and any other incoming Labour Government to rejoin Creative Europe as a priority. We also urge the UK Government to engage positively with the EU Commission's proposal to open negotiations with them on youth mobility and to constructively negotiate a deep and a generous agreement with the European Union.
I call question number 7, Elena Whittam, who is joining us remotely. Ms Whittam.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what its assessment is of any impact that Brexit is having on Scotland's culture sector.
Cabinet Secretary.
The UK Government's decision to leave the European Union has ended freedom of movement. Along with the UK Government's failure to negotiate a mobility agreement for creative professionals with the EU, this is making a vital international activities such as touring in Europe far more difficult. Creative professionals now face barriers, including visa and customs requirements and restrictions on haulage. The loss of the Creative Europe programme, which plays a unique and a vital role in facilitating international cultural collaboration and developing cross-border networks. Without access to Creative Europe, the sector's opportunities to work and to build relationships internationally are sadly more limited.
Elena Whittam.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. A few years into the disaster that is Brexit, we are better placed to assess and even measure lost opportunities. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline any analysis of the damage done to Brand Scotland and our status as a leading nation for culture due to the impact of Brexit on performers and artists?
Cabinet Secretary.
As a government, we engage closely with stakeholders from across the culture sector to assess the full impact of Brexit. And we've repeatedly heard of creative professionals leaving the sector due to barriers to international opportunities, as well as international artists facing difficulties coming here. We recently held a consultation on our international culture strategy, in which a wide range of stakeholders detailed the impact of leaving the European Union on Scotland's culture sector. A good first step to turning all of that around would be for the United Kingdom to rejoin Creative Europe.
A supplementary, Alexander Stewart.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Several cultural organisations in Scotland have reported a decline in the ability to deliver their services. This is not because of Brexit, but because of the SNP's government's inability to provide adequate funding to the sector. Does the Cabinet Secretary not accept his government's funding failures have negatively impacted on the sector?
Cabinet Secretary.
It's a curious intervention from a party which is actually cutting culture spending in the rest of the United Kingdom, when the Scottish Government is increasing it. I know deep in his heart Alexander Stewart supports the Scottish Government's efforts to raise spending on culture, and I hope that I can continue to have his support, his party's support indeed, from right across the chamber in increasing the level of spending on culture. The Scottish Government has committed to a £100 million boost to culture spending in Scotland, which is in stark contrast to the United Kingdom government's cuts to culture in England and indeed the Labour government's cuts to culture in Wales.
And question number 8, Sharon Dye.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government whether Creative Scotland's funding will be increased during the next financial year.
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I'm pleased that the First Minister, when he was setting out his priorities for Scotland on the 22nd of May, recommitted to investing at least £100 million more annually in culture and the arts by the financial year 2028-29. As the Finance Secretary set out in her budget speech in December, the increases that we've provided this year were our first step on the route to investing at least £100 million more in the arts and culture by 28-29, and our aim is to increase arts and culture investment in 25-26, the next financial year, by at least a further £25 million.
Okay.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. In October 2023, the former First Minister pledged to double arts spending during the period of Creative Scotland's next funding programme. But we are now faced with a stark reality. Creative Scotland has received bids worth £87.5 million for its multi-year funding programme, yet only £40 million is available, a significant shortfall. Mm. The shortfall puts many of Scotland's theatres, music venues and festivals at risk, potentially leading to Creative Scotland rejecting 55% of applications. At the same time, the body has been criticised for giving funding to an explicit show. This has received significant backlash and inevitably lowered public confidence. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline if the Scottish Government are going to take any action to ensure that funding is given to projects which are deemed appropriate?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I think Sharon Dowie knows that it's not for the Scottish Government to make individual grant funding to cultural organisations. We have a separation of government from arts funding in this way in this country. That's why we have an arm's length cultural funding organisation called Creative Scotland. It's really important that we have that separation. I thought up until now we actually had consensus across the parties on all of that. Where I think we do agree is we want to make sure that whether it's Creative Scotland or directly funded cultural organisations like our national performing companies receive the funding that they require. As I've already committed to, the First Minister has committed to, we are set to increase funding in culture in Scotland. I think that's a good thing and stands in stark contrast to what the UK government is doing in England and what Labour is doing in Wales.
And supplementary, voice of charity.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Following standstill funding, Creative Scotland will only be able to fund an estimated 45% of long-term funding applications. Along with this, we have been waiting 18 months for the overhaul of long-term cultural funding from Creative Scotland after it was postponed due to lack of confidence or clarity on its future finance. Does the Cabinet Secretary agree that the Creative Scotland needs clarity on its long-term funding so our creative organisation can be secure in their future?
Cabinet Secretary.
I agree that there are major funding changes going through at the present time, and I think there is still cross-party consensus that multi-annual year funding for our cultural organisations funded through Creative Scotland is a good thing, and Creative Scotland is trailblazing in this respect. There are other parts of the third sector which do not receive multi-annual year funding, so it's really important that Creative Scotland is able to introduce that. I wish them well in doing that. I think he understands, and perhaps Sharon Dowie also understands, that in a call out for funding, cultural organisations have asked for maximum funding that they can receive. I understand that. We all need to operate within our means, but the means that we are putting to the disposal of the culture and arts sector in Scotland are going up, whilst in England they're being cut under the Tories, and in Wales under Labour they're being cut too.
And supplementary, briefly, Evelyn Tweed.
The funding mentioned affirms the Scottish Government's confidence in the Scottish culture sector and the principles of their culture strategy. With this in mind, what recent calls has the Cabinet Secretary made on the UK Government to match that stated ambition and increase its investment in arts and culture?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I've repeatedly written to the Secretary of State and I've spoken to her, highlighting the importance of providing adequate support to the sector. At the first meeting of the Culture and Creative Industries Interministerial Group on the 2nd of May this year, I highlighted to the Secretary of State for the DCMS the challenges facing the sector as a result of financial constraints, the need to ensure that the UK Government provides adequate investment in the sector, and discussed existing initiatives to support the sector that could be built upon, including tax relief in the sector.
Excuse me, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. That concludes portfolio questions on Constitution, External Affairs and Culture and Parliamentary Business. There will be a short pause before we move on to the next item of business. Thank you. The next item of business is portfolio questions on justice and home affairs. Again, I would appreciate succinct questions and answers in order to allow as many members to have the opportunity to get in as possible. With that, I call question number one, Evelyn Tweed.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to address the needs and welfare of women prisoners in light of the reported challenges arising from a growing prison population.
Cabinet Secretary Angela Constance.
Presiding Officer, the needs and welfare of all those in our care remains a key priority for the Scottish Government and the Scottish Prison Service. SPS continue to manage those in custody with a person-centred approach and together with their partners deliver a range of trauma-informed support and services to women in custody which are aimed to meet their specific needs. However, I have been clear that the critical pressures experienced by the prison service and the impact that is having on women and men in prison and staff requires urgent action, and that is why I laid regulations before Parliament last week to seek approval to use emergency release power within the Bail and Release from Custody Scotland Act 2023.
Evelyn Tweed.
It is welcome that the Scottish Prison Service is committed to becoming a more trauma-informed organisation. With this in mind, what steps is the Scottish Prison Service taking through the use of available technology to help create safe and secure environments where this is viable?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Scottish Prison Service have invested in technologies to support their commitment to safety, security and to becoming a trauma-informed organisation. Rapid scan machines, which are available in every prison, and body scanners, which are available in 11 establishments, further enhance a comprehensive suite of security measures deployed to keep our prisons safe. SPS do, however, remain vigilant to the threat posed through the introduction of contraband and ensure that applied tactical measures complement the use of these technologies. Advancements in technology have also allowed SPS to roll out in-cell telephony throughout their estate. This facility supports positive mental health and well-being for those in the care of SPS, creating a holistic approach to security and, of course, to being trauma-informed.
Supplementary, Pauline McNeill.
Women are routinely being strip searched in Scottish prisons despite ministers saying that 5 years ago the practice would be reduced, and the Minister, Cabinet Secretary, will know it's particularly re-traumatising for female prisoners who have suffered abuse in the past. Only this morning, Wendy Sinclair, Gebbin Chief Inspector of Prisons, has written to the Cabinet Secretary asking for this practice to stop. Linda Allen, whose daughter Katie took her own life in Pullman Prison, said that repeated strip searching was a major factor in her death. I asked the Cabinet Secretary, how quickly does she think this practice can come to an end?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I have already been in correspondence with the Chief Inspector of Prisons with regard to this very serious matter. I, of course, share the Chief Inspector's concerns, although it has to be noted that the Chief Inspector has also acknowledged that there can be legitimate role for body searching if there is robust intelligence or robust reasonable grounds. But the point that the member makes on the importance of trauma-informed practice also relates to the answer to my question to Ms Tweed in terms of advancing the use of technology, because the use of body scanners, for example, reduces the need for body searches. But I am committed to continue to engage, not just with the inspector on this. I've already had a discussion with the Chief Executive of the Scottish Prison Service on this, and I have sought further assurances that body searching will only be used where there is robust grounds and robust intelligence for this, and I am due to have further discussions with the Scottish Prison Service on this matter.
And supplementary, Sharon Dowie.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Natalie Beale, Governor of HMP Glenochle, said that it is becoming increasingly difficult to deal with prisoners in their 60s and 70s. In 2018, the Scottish Prison Service spent £636,000 in prisoner social care, but that had trebled to £2.1 million in 2022. Given the growing population in Scottish prisons, what action is the Scottish Government taking to deal with the needs of the increasingly complex prison population?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I'm grateful to Ms Dowie for raising this important point. It was a matter that I have discussed with Parliament in a number of previous statements to this place, because Ms Beale is quite correct in that there isn't just an increasing prison population, there is also an increasingly elderly population, and what comes with that is significant health and social care needs. So, as I've previously stated to Parliament, that there is engagement with SPS and also with the Prison Healthcare Group, that cross-government group, around how we could better address the needs of community safety and security within our establishments, but also ensure better care for elderly long-term prisoners.
Question number two, Bill Kidd.
Thank you. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what role the Scottish Government Resilience Room would play in the event of a major nuclear incident.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, civil and defence nuclear safety are reserved matters. However, the Scottish Government holds responsibility for the off-site consequence management of a nuclear incident affecting Scotland. The Scottish Government Resilience Room is the Scottish Government's central coordination mechanism for responding to civil contingencies and complex emergencies. In the case of a major nuclear incident, it would activate to facilitate an effective Scottish Government response to the incident. It would provide Scottish ministers and senior officials with situational awareness, facilitate government coordination and support communication with responders at all levels in Scotland and, of course, with the UK Government.
Bill Kidd.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary. As the Cabinet Secretary is aware, the UK's nuclear submarine fleet is based at Faslane, 25 miles from Glasgow, and that in the event of a major nuclear incident, the MOD's own conservative projections suggest wholesale evacuation within a 30-mile radius and a shelter warning for everyone extended over a 75-mile radius. Given the increasing frequency of nuclear incidents on the Clyde and the very real danger to life this could present, does the Minister agree with me that all parties in this Parliament should work together in calling for the removal of nuclear weapons from Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I am of course in favour of all parties working together, and the Scottish Government's position on nuclear weapons is clear and long-standing. We are firmly opposed to the possession, threat and use of nuclear weapons. They are strategically and economically wrong. They are indiscriminate and devastating in their impacts. Their use would bring unspeakable humanitarian suffering and widespread environmental damage. And the Scottish Government has consistently expressed a commitment to remove nuclear weapons from Scotland in the safest and most expeditious manner possible, following a vote for independence. And this position was last set out in the recent Building a New Scotland paper, An Independent Scotland's Place in the World.
Question number three, Jackson Carlow.
To ask the Scottish Government what support it is providing to Police Scotland to tackle violent crimes in local communities.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, the latest Scottish Crime and Justice Survey results show a 58% fall in violent crime since 2008-09, with an increase in the number of adults feeling safe in their local communities over the same time. We welcome this encouraging progress, but are not complacent. Despite difficult financial circumstances due to UK government austerity, our budget for 2024-25 includes record police funding of £1.55 billion, an increase of nearly £93 million, and this investment is ensuring that Scotland continues to have more police officers per capita than England and Wales, with 30 officers per 10,000 of the population at 31st of March 2024, compared to 24 in England and Wales at 30th September 2023.
Jackson Carlow.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for a response? The police quarterly report presented to East Renfrewshire Council confirmed that there continued to be an overall increase in non-sexual crimes of violence in East Renfrewshire, up to 68 from the 55 offences recorded from the same period the previous year. Now, I think the Cabinet Secretary and I entered Parliament at the same time in 2007, and she will remember that the proudest boast of her government by the end of that Parliament was that they'd increased police numbers by 1,000 officers. So obviously I'm dismayed to find that we now have the lowest level of police numbers since 2008. So to tackle violent crimes in East Renfrewshire and across Scotland, would the Cabinet Secretary not agree with me that increasing the number of police officers should once again be a priority for the Scottish Government to help keep our local communities safe?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, I would like to assure Mr Carlow that policing most certainly does remain a key priority of this Government. I am concerned, however, to hear of those monthly reports around violent crime in his constituency. I do know, however, that the longer-term trend for his constituency from 2006-07 to 2022-23 is actually a 36% reduction in violent crime in his constituency, and that is a greater reduction than the country as a whole, where the reduction has been 25%. But nonetheless, I take seriously his concerns around that recent fluctuation over the monthly figures. And he may, of course, also be reassured to know that as of 31st of March this year, in G Division, which covers again his constituency, there are 2,459 officers, and that's actually 72 more than the previous quarter.
And supplementary, Audrey Nicol.
Apologies, I didn't hear you. Thank you, Presiding Officer. Despite the deeply challenging financial circumstances due to the UK Government financial settlement, can the Cabinet Secretary provide any update regarding the steps being taken to ensure the increased Scottish Police Authority resource budget supports further police recruitment?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, while the recruitment and deployment of police officers is of course a matter for the Chief Constable, I am reassured that she is taking action to get officer numbers to between 16,500 and 16,600. More than 310 new officers have commenced their training this year, with plans to recruit around a further 840 new officers between July and the end of March.
And supplementary, Colette Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I recently met with East Kilbride Victims of Teen Violence, a group of local residents affected by and shocked with recent events in the town. Can the Cabinet Secretary outline the work the Scottish Government is taking forward alongside the police with important organisations including Scottish Violence Reduction Unit and Medics Against Violence, and how their expertise can be used in towns like East Kilbride, where police data shows a significant rise in youth violence?
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, firstly, I share the member's concern about youth crime and understand that in East Kilbride, Police Scotland are investigating the incident and have deployed additional patrols to reassure the community. Through our violence prevention framework, we are supporting a programme of action backed by over £2 million this year to prevent and reduce violence across Scotland. In East Kilbride, it is supporting the targeted work of Medics Against Violence and No Knives, Better Lives to prevent youth violence in the first place. While such problems should be a concern to each and every one of us in this chamber, the member, I hope, can take some reassurance that, as I've highlighted, there has been an overall reduction in youth crime and crime generally, with violent crime decreasing by 58% since 2008-09.
Question number 4, not lodged. Question number 5, Myrtle Fraser.
Thank you. To ask the Scottish Government what discussions it has had with Police Scotland in relation to its guidance on recording non-crime hate incidents.
Cabinet Secretary.
Presiding Officer, Police Scotland published their interim guidance on responding to hate crime on 9 May 2024, which includes information on the recording and handling of non-crime hate incidents. While the recording of non-crime hate incidents and the development of guidance is an operational matter for Police Scotland, the Chief Constable and I discussed the matter when we met on the 30th of April.
Myrtle Fraser.
Can I thank the Cabinet Secretary for her response? I am aware that following concerns that I and others raised about the lawfulness of the Police Scotland policy on recording non-crime hate incidents, they have now changed their policy to bring it into line with the Miller judgment. They appear to have done so from the 1st of April, but it took them another 5 weeks to update their policy and tell anyone it was changing. And only then was their website actually updated. So while that change is welcome, can the Cabinet Secretary now tell us what will happen to all the non-crime hate incidents which were recorded under the old policy, which Police Scotland have tacitly accepted was unlawful?
Cabinet Secretary.
Signing officer, firstly, let me reassure Mr Fraser that this isn't just a matter that I have discussed with the Chief Constable. I have also taken the opportunity to discuss it with the Chair of the Scottish Police Authority Board and have discussed this at length with Martin Evans, because the SPA have that crucial role in terms of the scrutiny of operational matters of Police Scotland. But obviously I take very seriously the concerns that are expressed in this chamber. I'm not quite sure, I don't think Police Scotland would have the same narration or interpretation of what is lawful or unlawful that Mr Fraser has articulated. But given that the detail of this policy is very firmly located in an operational space, I will ask the Chief Constable or the Chair of SPA to reply directly to Mr Fraser on that point he raises.
Question number six, Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to reports that the Scottish justice system is close to collapse and that solicitors are taking industrial action.
Minister Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm aware of the position adopted by the Scottish Solicitors Bar Association. Legal aid solicitors play a crucial role in our justice system, which is why since 2021 there has been an investment of £31 million to legal aid. We will continue to work with the legal profession and others to identify measures to improve and reform Scotland's legal aid system. We will continue to work and support our justice partners in achieving the outcomes described in the Vision for Justice in Scotland by taking forward a programme to drive key areas of reform, including criminal justice efficiency under the Criminal Justice Efficiency Programme. The 2024-25 budget provides almost £3.8 billion to be invested across the justice system.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? One of the reasons for the industrial action is the Scottish Government's proposals for a pilot of rape trials conducted by a single judge without a jury in the Victims, Witnesses and Justice Reform Scotland Bill. The proposed pilot trials have had a mixed reaction from victims and survivors of rape. Survivors have shared concerns with the Criminal Justice Committee that not even judges are without unconscious bias and the decision resting with one judge. It's clear the Scottish Government haven't been able to secure widespread support for the legal sector or survivors for the pilot project. So will the Minister therefore support amendments at stage two to remove these provisions from the draft legislation?
Minister.
Thank you. The Cabinet Secretary has gone to stage one and she will continue to consider the recommendations from the Criminal Justice Committee and stakeholders.
And supplementary, Rona Mackay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Can the Minister reaffirm that the Scottish Government is committed to the principle of legal aid, which ensures free legal services are available to those most in need?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Yes, the Scottish Government remains committed to the principle of legal aid. We have maintained our resourcing of legal aid and have not actually cut its availability. It is a demand-led budget directly linked to application numbers, and all who are eligible will continue to benefit from it.
Question number seven, Fergus Ewing.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on whether there are excessive delays in the holding of fatal accident inquiries.
Solicitor General Ruth Charteris.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, the decision to hold a fatal accident inquiry is taken after thorough and independent investigation, the timeframe for which depends on the nature and circumstances of the death. There are often legitimate reasons for prolonged investigation, including the need to await the outcome of investigations by reporting agencies, to consider reports from agencies, or to instruct expert evidence. The Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service has significantly reformed its processes in recent years to improve the quality of death investigations and reduce the time taken to investigate deaths and bring FAIs to court. However, in some cases, FAIs have simply taken too long to commence and we appreciate and very much regret the impact which waiting for investigations to conclude has on families.
Fergus Ewing.
Solicitor General, what faith can bereaved families have in the justice system when they have to wait in some cases for 8 years before an FAI is actually held, and when they're fobbed off with explanations that appear to have come from the bumper book of excuses? Will the Solicitor General, therefore, or the Lord Advocate, come before this Parliament and give a full statement so that Parliament as a whole can scrutinise this failure of the current system?
Solicitor General.
I recognise that all families who have lost a loved one rightly expect investigations into the death to be progressed as expeditiously as possible. And I offer my sincere apologies to all families who have simply waited too long for FAI proceedings to commence. We want to do better. To that end, we have been working hard to make changes, and significant modernisation has taken place. For example, criminal investigations and the wider death investigations now proceed in parallel, so that FAIs can begin swiftly after the conclusion of criminal proceedings. We're working with specialists and other partner agencies to reduce the time it takes to conclude the investigations. Every death investigation over 2 years old, and also deaths in custody, are monitored by senior management through a case management panel process. We've also instituted a death investigations improvement board. Presiding officer, death investigations are a difficult, sensitive and hugely important area of work which COPFS strives to do well. There are inherent challenges in death investigations which are just not unique to Scotland. There are clear indications that the situation is improving. However, neither myself nor the Lord Advocate are beyond self-reflection, and if there is a need for a statement, then either of us would be happy to do so.
And supplementary, Russell Finlay.
Thank you, President Officer. Typically, a few dozen FAIs take place each year, while all other deaths are considered behind closed doors at the Crown Office. Compare this with England and Wales, where tens of thousands of coroner's inquests are held in public. Now, families keep being failed by Scotland's slow and ineffective system of investigating sudden, suspicious, accidental and unexplained deaths. So does the Solicitor General agree that a root and branch review of FAIs is needed?
Solicitor General.
Presiding officer, in our system, the Lord Advocate will instruct a discretionary fatal accident inquiry where it's in the public interest for one to be held. That's in addition to those FAIs where it's compulsory to hold one. We investigate a large number of deaths every year. This year we deal with approximately 14 deaths, the majority of which concluded within 12 weeks. In many cases, it's simply the case that there are no lessons to be learned from the tragedy, and it's enough that the family are made aware of what happened to their loved one. Scotland is not the only jurisdiction where a small number of complex deaths can take a long time to properly investigate. Although coroner's inquests begin rapidly in England, it still takes many years to reach a conclusion. That's not, of course, to diminish or dismiss the responsibility to investigate deaths as quickly as possible and to place the dignity of the deceased and their families at the heart of the process. I can only speak for the work being carried out by the dedicated and experienced and independent team within the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service, who, as I've indicated, are working hard to make changes and bring forward an increase in speed.
And question number 8, Tess White.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the implementation of the Hate Crime and Public Order Scotland Act 2021, since it came into force on the 1st of April 2024.
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Hate Crime and Public Order Scotland Act 2021 sends a strong message to victims, perpetrators and communities that offences motivated by prejudice will not be tolerated. The Act consolidates, maintains and extends protections aggravated by prejudice, as well as including stirring up of hatred offences for all characteristics covered in the hate crime legislative framework. The offence of stirring up racial hatred has been in Scots law since 1986. We have worked closely with Police Scotland and other justice partners to ensure the Act's effective implementation, and we will continue to do so.
Tess White.
Minister, I've been liaising with Police Scotland about engagement with women's groups on the implications of the Hate Crime Act for their lawful meetings. Disappointingly, Police Scotland has indicated to me that it will not participate in this vital engagement while it's in the process of developing longer-term policies around the Act. Does the Minister or Cabinet Secretary agree with me that input from women's groups should influence this process, not occur after it has concluded? And will the Minister and Cabinet Secretary make representations to Police Scotland to ensure that women's voices are heard?
Minister.
Thank you. Yes, I do agree, and we have been told that Police Scotland are going to consult internally and externally.
And brief supplementary, Emma Roddick.
Thank you. Police Scotland data shows us that the volume of reports has consistently reduced week on week. So does the Cabinet Secretary believe that the early high numbers of reports that we saw were due to widespread misinformation about the Act, including, unfortunately, from members in this chamber?
Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Recent Police Scotland data shows us that the volume of reports at week 7 has actually reduced by more than 99% compared to the first week of the Act's commencement. The fact we have seen so many reports since implementation reinforces the importance of the Hate Crime Act. Whilst the commentary surrounding the Act during its implementation saw misrepresentation, it is important to remember that the Hate Crime Act was passed by 82 members of this Parliament. People and communities at the sharp end of hatred in their daily lives, simply for being who they are, should rightly look to this Parliament to stand with them, and the Scottish Government will continue to do so.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes portfolio questions on justice and home affairs. There will be a very short pause to allow frontbench teams to change positions should they so wish. Thank you.